My topic today will be on applied anatomy in PCNL. First, let me start with the surface anatomy. We know that the kidneys are paired retroperitoneal structures and they are located on either side of the midline. The left kidney can reach as high as 11th rib and the right reaches only up to the 12th rib. The lower pole reaches L3, L4 vertebra and the hilum of the kidneys is roughly around T12, L1 level. Everybody, I think, knows about this, but let me just tell you again about the parallelogram of Morris, which involves drawing two vertical lines, the first 2.5 centimeter from the middle of the spine and the second 9.5 centimeter. These are two horizontal lines and these are two vertical lines and the two horizontal lines, one from the top of the spinous process of 11th thoracic vertebra and the second line from the spinous process of the third lumbar vertebra. And the kidney is most likely is going to be hiding in this area. Due to the conical shape of the psoas muscle, the kidney forms an axis, and everybody has to know about this axis because you need to know which way you're going to puncture. So the kidney lies at about 30 degrees tilted towards the midline and 30 degrees tilted towards posteriorly. So what in fact this happens is the upper pole of the kidney is more medial and more posterior than the lower pole, and the left kidney is slightly higher, and therefore a supracostal puncture is more likely in the left kidney. Why is the axis more important? Because as you can see in the second diagram, the puncture axis poses the risk of iatrogenic damage as the vessels are directly in level with the axis trajectory. So if you take the axis more medially, you are going to either injure the renal vessels or the great vessels. So you need to be very, very careful because the vessels are waiting for you on the trajectory of your puncture. Coming to the anatomical relationships of the kidney, anteriorly, the kidneys, you can see the left kidney is related to the spleen, colon, and the right kidney is related to the duodenum, liver, and the colon. Though the liver and the spleen are usually not enlarged, when they are enlarged, they can extend lateral to the kidney and can be in the line of your puncture. Both the ascending and the descending colon lie posterior to the right and left kidney, most commonly in the lower pole, in about 15% of the patients. The colon can also be very close to the kidney. There are studies to show that in the supine position, the colon is retrorenal in 2% of the cases, but in prone position, it's retrorenal in about 10% of the cases. Coming to the posterior extrarenal anatomy, that is the more important thing because that's where we take our needle through. The layers that are traversed by the needle are the skin, the subcutaneous fat, the body wall muscle, lumbar dorsal fascia, gerotous fascia, perirenal fat, and occasionally the diaphragm, pleura, and the intercostal space. The left kidney is crossed at the upper pole by the 11th and 12th ribs, but the right kidney is crossed only by the 12th rib. The diaphragm is traversed in all the intercostal punctures and occasionally even in punctures below the 12th rib. The posterior reflection of the pleura extends medially below the 12th rib also. So it can be expected the pleura is traversed in most of the intercostal punctures and most of the time it with no adverse effect. The lung usually lies in the 10th intercostal space, and punctures that are placed above the 10th rib pose a significant risk of damage to the lung. Coming to the ribs, they can present a lot of potential problems. First, they may not even appear on the line of the puncture on imaging, but still obstruct the path of the needle. If that happens, you will have to move the puncture site. The intercostal and nerves, vessels and nerves travel directly below the rib and are vulnerable during puncture. So puncture should be made at the upper border of the rib to avoid the neurovascular bundle. The intercostal spaces can be narrow and making insertion of dilator through that space may be difficult, especially as you are coming medially. Only 3% of the supra 12 punctures result in a pneumothorax, but as the lung is above the 11th rib, lung parenchymal injury, again and again I'm reiterating this, that It is rare unless the puncture is above the 10th rib, so avoid supra 10 punctures at all cost. And this, there's a diagram that shows you the safe area of the puncture. I'm not able to, let me just see if I can put my pointer there. Sorry, I'm not able to put my pointers there. As you can see, there's a line that is drawn from the tip of the 11th rib. So any line, the horizontal line below joining the tips of the 11th rib, any area up to the iliac crest is quite safe for a safe puncture without any adverse impact to the lung or the pleura. Coming to the vascular anatomy. Again, most of us have seen these diagrams quite frequently. We know that the main renal vessel splits into the anterior segment and the posterior segmental artery. The anterior segmental artery, the anterior branch supplies the apical, upper, middle and lower segments, and the posterior segmental artery supplies the posterior segment. The segmental artery, as they are coming near the infundibulum, they cross as lobar arteries and then which branch as interlobar arteries. And the interlobar arteries cross over at the tip of the calluses to form the interlobular and arcuate arteries, and these are all microvasculatures. So depending on the vascular anatomy, it is understood that the safest area of puncture is at the mouth of the calyx, and any other area there is a potential problem of hitting a larger vessel. And again, I am let me just see, yeah, I can put my pointer now. Can you see that this is the infundibulum, and you can see that there are the major vessels waiting, anterior and posterior, and any deviation or any extension of the puncture either anteriorly or posteriorly in the infundibulum, you are going to hit a big vessel, and that is going to lead to torrential bleeding. So you try to avoid infundibular punctures, and if you are going to make an infundibular puncture, take it laterally and do not go anteriorly or posteriorly to the infundibulum, and try to get into the mouth of the calyx as far as possible. Coming to the calyceal anatomy, there was a broad definition that most of the diagrams show that there are two groups of calyces, the anterior calyces and the posterior calyces, and the anterior calyces are placed laterally and the posterior calyces are placed medially. But this is not true, and this calyceal anatomy continues to intrigue the urologist. This way of telling that there are two rows, anterior and posterior, just an oversimplification. So the calyces are, in spite of not paying, they are directed anteriorly and posteriorly, and the posterior calyces usually point about 30 degrees backwards. So a puncture into a posterior calyx leads directly to the infundibulum and renal pelvis. The anterior calyces are directed more forward. So when you are doing a prone puncture and you enter the anterior calyx, the entry is at an acute angle and may be difficult to negotiate with dilators or rigid nephroscope. So the aim is to go and puncture a posterior calyx. But as the diagram says, the posterior calyx is not very simple and says that it'll just face, it'll be lateral and you can just enter the posterior calyx as that. So you need to have a good anatomical knowledge about the posterior calyx. And thanks to Sampaio and his classification of renal calyces, we have a little bit of idea on how the posterior calyces look like. The top diagram shows a Brodel type calyx, which has a long posterior calyx and is only 20 degree with respect to the frontal plane. This is the frontal plane and the posterior calyx is at 20 degrees. A short anterior calyx maintains a degree of 70 degrees to the frontal plane. About 70% roughly of the right kidneys have a Brodel configuration. And the other type of kidney is the Hodgson classification or the Hodgson type kidneys, where the posterior calyx are 70 degrees with relation to the frontal plane, and the anterior calyx are more or less horizontal at 20 degrees to the frontal plane. About 80% of the left kidneys belong to the Hodgson type of calyceal configurations. What Sampaio did was he injected a plastic resin into the kidneys and took a model of all the calyces and tried to classify the calyces, kidneys according to the calyceal anatomy. The group A1, which is the mid zone, is drained by minor calluses that depend on the superior inferior groups. This is the superior group of infundibulum, this is the inferior group, and all the mid zone is dependent on either the superior or the inferior. About 45% of the kidneys behave this way. The A2 group is the mid zone is drained by minor calluses that are crossing each other and are dependent on the superior and inferior calyx, but they cross. You can see that these two calluses are cross. About 17% belong to the A2 group. The B1 group is the mid zone calluses are drained into a minor calluses into a from the minor calluses into a major mid zone calyx. There's a separate mid zone major calyx. This is group B1. About 21% of kidneys behave this way. And group B2 is the mid zone has minor calluses that directly drain into the pelvis, and about 17% of kidneys behave this way. So this is the variations in anatomy of the calluses according to Sampayor's classification, and having a knowledge about this helps you in trying to plan your puncture on which calyx you want to enter. What Sampayor's endocast showed also that is the posterior calluses are lateral in only 20%, where the anterior calluses are lateral in about 28% of cases. In 53% of the cast study, the anterior and posterior calluses are variable position and either superimposed or alternately distributed. And it also showed the calluseal orientation was region dependent. The classical anterior and posterior arrangements were seen only in the midpole. The upper pole always had a compound calluseal system, and the anterior posterior arrangement of calluses was only seen in 58% of the lower pole calluses. And the lower pole calluses has a more complex arrangement of calluses. So Eisner looked at only the lower pole calluses, and he said that if the lower pole had two calluses, the more lateral calyx is likely to be the posterior calyx. If the lower pole had three calluses, the second calyx from the medial aspect is likely to be more posteriorly oriented. So with all this, you know that the simplification of lateral posterior and medial anterior is not going to be same. It's not going to be easy. And the only way that how Sampayor said that you can identify a posterior calyx is by injecting a small quantity of air through the retrograde pyelogram and see where the air settles into. And that helps you to identify the lower pole calyx or the posterior calyx. Sampayor also studied the relationship of vascular anatomy to the calluses, and found that the upper pole and infundibulum punctures are considered to be the highest risk of damage to the vasculature. And he also said that the upper pole has a lot of meshwork of vessels, and it's the bleeding chances are more in when you have an upper pole puncture. And he said that the most commonest segmental artery, the artery that can be injured, is the posterior segmental artery, which is vulnerable and can be easily damaged. And he found that the inferior pole puncture was considered to be the safest. But even in an inferior pole puncture, they found a large vessel, infundibular vessel, in about 38% of cases. Therefore, in principle, there is no safe region to puncture the kidney except the calyx itself. The blood vessels around the infundibulum lie anteriorly and posteriorly, and that's why puncture of the infundibulum is best done from laterally and should never traverse the opposite side. So coming to the take-home messages, you need to have a key to success in PCNL lies in a safe puncture, and you need to have a very good knowledge of calluseal and vascular anatomy to understand where to puncture it. The tip of the calyx is the safest area for puncture. Never shoot the needle or the dilator beyond the calyx. There are multiple vessels in wait. Thank you.